we're ready to take questions. There's a couple of students with mics. One I see here, and the other one is there. So please raise your hand, and I will moderate this session. Please.
Doctor, I wonder if you could talk a little bit about the relationship of the Palestinians in the United Nations. That's sort of an odd relationship, perhaps it could be of interest.
The Palestinian issue is going to be there permanently. It has to be. And it's not solvable. You've got two major issues there. One is very strong Palestinian support from the Arab League. The Arab League is the United Nations has voting blocks, the General Assembly. It's 27 countries of the Arab League will make certain that that issue is always very prominent. Then you've got the decolonization issue, and this one fits into decolonization. So that makes it an issue for the 120 members of the non-aligned movement. They're going to keep it there. And there isn't an easy solution. Palestine membership, Palestinian membership in the UN, membership belongs to a state. There is no internationally recognized Palestinian state. The two-state formula for a peace deal in the Middle East that would make Palestine a formal state, that's dead at the moment. It's not going anywhere. So there's a lot of pressure to bring them in as a member without a formal state. There are problems with that, obviously. The big difficulty with membership is you have two. Membership has to be voted on first by the General Assembly, then it must be approved by the Security Council. So it's understood the United States, for a minimum, would veto Palestinian formal membership. So they're there as an observer at the moment. But you get these resolutions out of the General Assembly urging membership. It's much like Republican resolutions coming out of the Congress to repeal Obamacare. It's almost identical. One of the reasons it's very easy to get those resolutions out of the Congress is the certainty they'd be vetoed by the President. You've got exactly the same thing going on with Palestinian membership. Very easy to get it out of the General Assembly. Hard to imagine it going very far forward. So this will continue to be a wrangling issue, I think.
Yes, right in the back there.
Is all that the same as our relationship with NATO?
There's a lot of similarity.
Can you repeat the question?
Yeah, the question was about the relationship between the United States and the UN as opposed to the United States and NATO. There is a lot of similarity. NATO is not a universal membership. It's a regional organization. It exclusively is a security organization as well, so it has a much narrower remit. But for the 28 member states, NATO is extraordinarily important. It generally operates on the basis of consensus. Its great strength is legitimate collective security. It has some important differences. Article 5 is the key to NATO, of course, which is an absolute security guarantee on behalf of any of the members that are attacked. There's nothing like that quite in the UN Charter. And NATO is more powerful in a lot of ways. The NATO Secretary General is much more powerful. The Secretary General of NATO can convene a meeting of the NATO Council and can tell them what they're going to talk about. The Secretary General of the United Nations cannot do that. So there's a relationship there. As we saw in cases like Kosovo in 1999, at the time of the Kosovo War, Western countries wanted to go to the United Nations and get approval from the United Nations to act in Kosovo. When they couldn't get it, they went to NATO instead. Same thing happened in Libya in 2011.
Yes.
Professor, you touched on Kosovo. The Balkan Wars, in some ways, led to the rise of a doctrine known as humanitarian intervention, at least gave momentum to that doctrine. Some people translate that as the responsibility to protect. So when a prince or a nation or the national authorities abuse their own citizens, does the UN still think that there's an opportunity for intervention? What would you say is the evolutionary track of this so-called doctrine?
It's very important. In 2001, a independent committee, which is to say, chosen by no one but themselves, essentially, the Australian government, actually, was a big force behind this commission in 2001, put out a report on the responsibility to protect R2P. It was largely responsive to things that happened in the Balkans, as you say. The idea was that when you had a hideous humanitarian situation, crimes against humanity, the international community had an obligation to do something, had an obligation to intervene to stop a crime against humanity, so that you would never again have a situation like we faced in Cambodia after the Khmer Rouge took over in Cambodia in 1975. You would never again face a situation like we faced in Bosnia in 1991. That's the basic idea. The Secretary General at the time, Kofi Annan, was very supportive of this. Member states are generally supportive but suspicious. It violates the basic idea of state sovereignty, that states control their own territory. So for countries especially like Russia and China, which believe state sovereignty matters more than individual rights, this isn't the way ahead, generally. The Chinese are more accepting of it. The Chinese are not opposed in all situations. The United States is ambivalent, obviously. The big problem is how much do you do? And that's what we're facing in Syria. But no one wants to invade Syria. And shy of an invasion, we can't imagine a solution. So we sort of created the obligation, but we debate how to fulfill it, how much energy are we actually going to put in this. This is another one. This will not be resolved quickly.
I'm curious, how do they choose who gets the veto power? And of the 193 or 180 or so, have they ever thought of changing it or asked them yet?
This is the key to UN reform. UN reform means different things to different audiences. In the UN system, it's membership. The Security Council was set up in 1945. The countries with the veto are the victorious allies. And it leads to really obvious, strange discrepancies. The world's second most populous country is not a veto power. The world's third and fourth largest economies don't have vetoes. There are lots of oddities that happen as a result. In many ways, the United Nations is trapped in the world in 1945. You had a major debate in around 2005-2006 on UN reform, especially Security Council reform. Secretary General Kofi Annan was personally interested. He pushed the idea a lot. So the general idea was you would expand the Security Council. People were ambivalent about that. The General Assembly is already a zoo. You don't want to turn the Security Council into a second zoo. People were sensitive to that. On the other hand, if it represents a world of 1945, how legitimate is it in the world that you and I live in? They came up with formulas. Expand the rotating seats so you'd have 25 members. Make India, Japan, and Germany permanent powers without a veto. That was a lot of people like that. The barriers are every time you want to bring in someone, you're offending someone else. So you want to bring India in as a permanent member. The Pakistanis had something to say on that. You want to bring in Germany as a non-veto permanent member. The Italians went crazy. You get into this. Japan will never be on the Security Council as a permanent member because China won't stand for it. It went away.
We had a question. Well, several questions now. Let's start back in there on the left.
You said that the United Nations wants to end poverty by 2030. What is the United Nations doing to make that happen?
This is what the Sustainable Development Goals are all about. This is the SDG process. So the SDGs are, I told you total of 16 specific development goals. Each one has an average of 10 goals under that category, so you've got close to 200 goals in this framework for organizing all global assistance. And it's a combination of assistance from international organizations, from governments. There's a lot of business activity that's been brought in, a lot of non-governmental organizations. So this, the SDGs are going to be a huge meeting that keeps going to the year 2030. And they're going to keep talking. And that's kind of how they actually coordinate all of this. Because this is the General Assembly, you can't tell anybody what to do. The only person the General Assembly can tell what to do is the Secretary General of the organization. That's not much. So they're going to keep talking about this. But if you go, there's now, of course, there's a major SDG website, go to it, and you have to click for a while to get to the specifics, because this is a big tree. It's a global initiative. And this is leaving aside, you know, the definitional issues, you know, what is poverty? What have you alleviated it? What have you eliminated it? They're working on that one, too.
Just under the last row.
I was wondering, what kind of people do you hire? Like, what are the job qualifications to work for the UN?
The best way to get a job with the UN is not to go to the UN. Go find a non-governmental organization to work for them. So the say you're interested in human rights issues, then Human Rights Watch, Amnesty International, those are the big organizations. There are a lot of others, obviously. They're much bigger than the UN. They spend a lot more money, and their staff turns over pretty fast because these are hard jobs. People burn out. They look for something where they don't have to, well, you know, where they can sleep in a real bed every now and then, amongst other things, because it is a tough life. So the NGO community develops all the expertise, and there's a bit of rotation between that and the UN system. So it's very common for people to start working with the NGOs and then get contract work with the UN. It's hard to become an international civil servant. One of the 4,000, that's very difficult because those positions tend to be allocated on a national basis. The United States has 4% of the world's population, and that's how the allocation is done, generally. The United States is overrepresented, of course, but it's difficult. So, career-wise, it's hard to get into the UN system. It's much easier to get into activity that's related to what the UN's doing.
Yes. One more in the back there, then we move to the front again.
I believe you spoke about an upcoming needed reform to the UN, and what type of reform would you like to see?
Asked me that before. I'm pretty clueless, actually. How would you actually make the thing work better? And I don't have a good answer to that. Expanding the Security Council slightly would help. A big difficulty that we face in all kinds of UN institutions is the problem of consensus. Because the members are sovereign states, and you often need their cooperation, there's enormous pressure to do whatever it takes to get them to go along with whatever the issue is. And in order to do that, you make these compromises and you end up with these resolutions that don't do anything. So sometimes you need less consensus. Here's an example is there's a negotiation in Geneva to stop all production of fissile material, the highly enriched uranium and plutonium used to make nuclear weapons. It's still legal to produce that. For military purposes. They're big stockpiles. Some countries have all they need. There are kinds of specific issues. But the FISBAN treaty is an obvious way to limit the spread of nuclear weapons. The barrier right now is Pakistan. The negotiation involves some 60 countries. 59 think it's a great idea. The Pakistanis don't. Rule of consensus is what they do in Geneva in the disarmament negotiations. You can't get around your Pakistan problem. So sometimes you need more voting. Sometimes you do need to be able to isolate sovereign states. But that requires reconsidering a lot of, you know, really foundational stuff.
Yes. Mike's done.
We're back to Syria just for a moment, if you could. The play, or the part that the UN could play in this, is there one really, or do we kind of have to stand off the side and watch the civil war continue to unfold? Is there a spot that the UN can step in and help to bring this to some kind of a resolution? Because there are those who want to throw more boots to the ground back again, sending us back into what we left. And it was really the general public that said we're tired, we want to get out. Now there are groups that are saying we need to go back in again. What part can the UN play? Or is there a part at all?
Yeah. This is the classical situation where the UN is very, very weak. You have a sovereign government that's a member of the UN. Syrian government is a UN member. It's a sovereign state. So under international law, there's very little that can be done. Until you develop a transformation in international law, such as the responsibility to protect, which gives the international community a basis for legally intervening. Now, there are barriers. Not only is it a sovereign state, it has one very strong ally on the Security Council in Russia, and it has a weaker ally in China. So it's very hard for the Security Council to act. We had a very similar situation in Libya in 2011, and the advocates for intervention ended up going to NATO, because that was what, they were all NATO members. They could make that work. They couldn't make the Security Council work. So the UN does peripheral things. It does endless humanitarian activity. It runs the camps, gets aid in. It also does, in addition to aid and assistance, it offers good offices. Good offices means trying to support negotiations, providing literally a place for the different sides to meet, often doing a lot of diplomacy, trying to get the sides to negotiate. Libya's a decent example there. The Libyan war has been very much restrained because of UN activism, diplomatic activism, which means getting hyperactive with literally hundreds of militias coordinating, trying to build some kind of a consensus for a national system of government. Very weak, but you know, ultimately, UN debates often turn into questions of the mandate. What can we get away with? What can we do? What does we have a Security Council resolution? What does it allow us to do? And what does it forbid? So there's big debates about the mandate, and the mandate in Syria is really weak.
We have to continue to repeat.
Non-governmental cross-border groups are becoming more and more of a question, such as ISIS, more and more of a question in our world today. What, if any, role does the United Nations have in non-government activities?
Yeah, that is so awkward. So the question is, how does the UN deal, not just with non-governmental organizations, with armed groups, non-state armed groups, NSAGs? And it's very hard for the UN. If they are operating exclusively within the territory of one country, the UN has no business whatsoever. It's that country's business. So, to give you an example, the FARC is a 50-year-old rebellion in Colombia, right? UN doesn't go near it because the Colombians don't want them to. It's Colombia's problem. You know, thank you very much. We'll deal with it. They're dealing with it for 50 years. Most insurgencies, that's what's going on. So lots of insurgencies in India, in Pakistan, Philippines, for example, or Myanmar. The UN doesn't go near any of those because they're essentially, those conflicts are owned legally by the home government, host country government. Now you get a multinational aspect, the UN can get involved. Secretary General Ban Ki-moon announced last week a new plan for coordinated activity on terrorist, not terrorist recruitment. The word terrorist is too touchy in the UN system for historical reasons. Violent extremist recruitment. And it's just a, it's a plan, it's a framework. It asks countries to do things to deal with recruitment into these organizations. ISIS, you can get a resolution, you can do a little bit, but it's really, really hard. This is not what the UN does best. And so if you need a solution, the UN could be part of it, but it probably isn't going to lead.
Question in the front, and then in the next row, please.
Could you speak to the perspectives on the regionalization issues here? For instance, in the African Union for the past 8 years, they've been looking at extend that.
Can you speak up a little bit
into
the mic?
Oh, sure, sorry. For the past 8 years, the African Union has been creating the African Standby Force. And recently, last year, the Arab League signed a document pretty much hoping to institute a similar standby force. Could you speak on some perspectives?
Regionalization has a whole history. NATO is a good example of regionalization. And it's understood that countries within the region who potentially face security threats from conflicts in the region, they're stakeholders. They're involved no matter what. A classical example of that is the problem with the Lord's Resistance Army, which started in Uganda. I think the LRA got started about 25 years ago in Uganda. It's now a regional Central African phenomenon. So, I mean, they're in the Central African Republic, they're in South Sudan, they're still in Uganda, other countries in the region. Democratic Republic of Congo has a smaller problem with Lord's Resistance Army. The LRA is tiny. Its total membership is, combatants, is well under 500 people. But no one state can do it, so you have to have a regional solution. In addition, with Africa, you've got a tension in the system. A lot of Africans are very suspicious of the United Nations system, which they regard as a form of neocolonialism. Bold global initiatives on security are put together, and they actually mean Africa. The International Criminal Court is the classical example of this. So the International Criminal Court was created in 1999-2001 to have a legal mechanism to prosecute and punish national leaders suspected of war crimes. It quickly turned into a court for African leaders. And there was a lot of unhappiness with that. So coming out of pressure, especially from the African Union and Addis Ababa, you've got the development of African institutions. Other countries love it because they don't want to send peacekeeping forces any more than they have to. So if you get African forces to do that, this is really good. So you've got a lot of financing for this actually coming from the European Union.
I was wondering how would the UN, or even if they do, help facilitate like release of hostages, such as like the situation that just happened in Iran?
Mm-hmm. This is where we talk about the question was about the UN role in international hostage situations, such as this group of sailors had some difficulty in the Middle East. And the answer is good offices. The UN has enormous prestige. So the Secretary General, if asked to, he won't do this all by himself. One of the parties to the conflict has to ask the Secretary General to do this. The Secretary General will typically name a special representative. And the special representative will go and do the diplomatic shuttle. We'll go between the capital cities, try to get a negotiation going, and work on the problem. This is a classical example, though. In this case, the states party to the problem solved it themselves. They didn't need the UN, and they didn't bother. In other words, it was an easy problem for them. And so this is what we see so often. If the problem's easy, if the states can solve it by themselves, they do. Only when it becomes totally impossible will they call the UN Secretary General. He's a very polite man. He'll say yes.
Anybody else from that section in the front there?
Yeah.
You mentioned the peacekeeping forces, and you had a slide that showed Brazilian forces somewhere. How is that decided on what countries participate in providing these Muhammadan troops?
Basically, how does the UN choose peacekeepers? Typically, the UN doesn't. The peacekeepers choose themselves. Most countries don't want to send peacekeepers. It's expensive. It's expensive. It doesn't do anything for your own national security. The commitments can be very lengthy. I mean, we've got there's a UN peacekeeping observer mission in Korea that's been there since 1953. This one that's been in Cyprus since 1974. You know, this could be long-term commitment stuff. So you're looking for volunteers. The Brazilians are in Haiti because they want Haiti. This is a major part of Brazilian foreign policy, stabilizing Haiti. A lot of peacekeeping missions are made up by very small countries. Nepal is a great example. Fiji is another really good example. Peacekeeping became a way to subsidize their militaries. America doesn't want to send its military. We basically refuse to allow American troops to be used as peacekeepers. But we'll finance the Nepalese or the Fijians. So it becomes mutually beneficial. The difficulty with this is some of these countries, peacekeeping becomes very lucrative. It starts subsidizing the whole Ministry of Defense. And they get addicted to it. And then you send them back home, and they lose all the money, and the soldiers get angry. So the Fijian peacekeepers got home about 5 years ago, rioted, and took over the country.
We have a question here.
Doctor, you mentioned in one of your slides that the UN tends to be a natural punching bag. U.S. Congress. I understand the dynamics behind that. Typically, it arises when the annual subsidy or grants of money is being considered in the authorization or appropriations bill. Do you see problems ahead in the next couple of years given the state of the U.S. Congress? And then this will become also problematic getting the UN, U.S. funding for the UN.
Budgetary problems with the U.S. Congress? there are a lot of this is one of them. This will be. There's always pressure to reduce this kind of spending. Something that the U.S. government used to do, this was very big in the 70s through the 90s, was you wanted to build support for international organization activity, for development assistance, and that sort of thing. The Congress, congressional leaders in this case, would get as part of an authorization bill creation of a commission to investigate aid or international organization activity. And the real purpose of having a commission wasn't to study what you were doing, it was to educate a bunch of congressmen what all of this was about. Because they talk more than they know, right? So get them to know a little bit more was the idea. This was fairly successful, but that hasn't been done. This is a very convenient whipping boy. I can well understand where you got into a situation where you financed it because you needed it so badly as a whipping boy.
Okay, one last question.
What is your input on Gaddafi's gold money plan?
Say that again, please.
What is your input on Gaddafi's gold money plan? He had an idea to use gold currency, and basically it would have devastated the dollar.
Gold standard. It's not Gaddafi's, it's America's plan. America is the home of millions and millions of gold bugs. Some people in this room have bought large quantities of gold, and it's sitting in vaults at home or in the bank. And at the moment, you know, they go home and either they read the report every day and either smile or cry, depending on what the gold's doing. It's also showed up in the presidential election. The UN does not do monetary policy.
Okay.
Sovereign states do it. The United States could go to the gold standard if it wanted to. Getting the international system to do it, that would happen outside the UN. Because states are sovereign, and they won't let the UN deal with their monetary policy.
All right, well, thank you. Right? Wouldn't you like to see that? No pressure. No pressure. This is a community-based event. Thank you all for coming here. And we have a lot of hungry students, so please feel free to bring food. I understand why you ran out, pretty much. Please visit our webpage, www.hrwac.com. Next week, we have John Pfeiffer, who's the Director of Foreign Policy and Focus from Washington, D.C., going to talk about the Koreas, which is very hot in the news now. And also, please register for the year in review. Just go to our webpage, which is on the 21st at Norfolk State University in the beautiful Wilder Auditorium there. And we hope to see you next week and Thursday. Bye.